If you've ever read the latter parts of the Romance of the Three Kingdoms novel, you'll remember the barbaric Nanman tribes and the Shu-Han War of Pacification in Nanjong, which is better described as an imperial crackdown on an ethnic tribe fighting for their independence. And nearly everything else you know about the war is probably wrong as well.
I'm Cody Bonds, and this is a mostly accurate history of Zhuge Liang's southern campaign.
In October of AD 222, Emperor Liu Bei, founder of the Shu Han Empire and former sandal salesman, lost the Battle of Xiaoting. Because declaring yourself emperor is a tricky business, other people can start getting ideas, and his neighbor, the King of Wu, fancied a new title as well, which led to old Longears Liu Bei getting the worst of it. Because, in the words of the guy that beat him, if you spread your army out over a 200-mile front of swamp and forest, you're gonna have a bad time. The hero of the Romance of the Three Kingdoms descended into self-pity, drinking too much, eating poorly, and forgoing any semblance of exercise.
He was dead within a few months.
After a regal reign of only 2 years, this left the Shu Han Empire in the hands of Liu Bei's son, Liu Shan, who was literally dropped on his head as a child. And this is who was going to lead the Shu Han in a three-way war for control of China. Smelling an opportunity, Yong Kai, governor of Jiangning in the south, took advantage of the turmoil and tried to negotiate out of his fealty contract, or possibly even switch imperial service providers. This prompted a flurry of letters from Shu Han Comcast headquarters to try and stop a full-on rebellion in the south. But Yong Kai must have figured the Shu Han were paper tigers after Liu Bei's death, so he pulled the old, "The sky cannot have three suns, and a land cannot have three emperors, so I can't decide who my master is," which was a cutesy way of saying he already decided to pledge himself to the guy that had beaten Liu Bei, Sun Qian and the Kingdom of Wu. Partially because they were already on a winning streak, and partially because when you're promised money, power, booze, and a new pony, it's hard to say no. The Kingdom of Wu, meanwhile, got to rub salt in the wounds of their enemy and kick an empire while it was already down.
So wins all around.
With the blessing of the Kingdom of Wu, Yong Kai left to claim his new position as the governor of Yongcheng Commandery, only to find the existing governors wouldn't let him in, and had no intention of stepping down. When Yong Kai pressed the point, armed civilians appeared on the walls and told him to piss off or they'd leave him singing castrata. Most people would have given up and gone home at this point, but you don't claw your way to the top of the muck pile that was late Han bureaucracy by rolling over to a bunch of peasants. Instead, Yong Kai took his case to the local tribes. The Nanman people are actually an umbrella term that refers to all the tribes that once lived in southern China. Their name meaning literally the Southern Barbarians,
which is a surefire way of knowing that's not what they called themselves.
But since they didn't keep their own records, we're forced to go with the Shu Han version. Later Chinese stories like the Romance of the Three Kingdoms have them communing with animals, wearing loincloths, and using only rattan and bamboo armor.
You know, like savages.
Also, they're noticeably tanner than everyone else, but clearly that's unrelated to their treatment here. But as naked fanatics were running through the forests of Germania slaughtering Romans around this time, who's to say they're wrong? After all, this is a humid subtropical climate,
and I wouldn't wear clothes if they didn't make me either.
Yong Kai tried to stir up the Nanman himself, but found them less than interested in his ranting and raving. Since they weren't wearing pants, he assumed they were too dumb to listen properly, and undoubtedly began over-enunciating his words and making large hand gestures. Figuring they must all be dumb or deaf, Yong Kai instead took his case to a popular and influential local chief, Meng Huo. Yong Kai then spun him a tale of overtaxation, forced conscription, and administrative abuses that Meng Huo bought hook, line, and sinker, as few things get people fired up faster than tales of governmental goose-stepping. Meng Huo took this up as a rallying cry for the Nanman people, and soon the whole of southwestern China was up in arms, while Yong Kai steepled his fingers and tried not to smile too much. A nearby Yuxi commandery, Chief Gao Ding of the Su tribe, had tried the same thing back in AD 218, but it had never quite caught on. This rebellious OG thought throwing off a foreign oppressive government's yoke sounded like a jolly good idea and joined in by murdering the local governor. In response, the Shu Han government sent out a new administrator to talk things over and take charge, armed with a very impressive set of pins. Gao Ding killed that one as well. The Shu Han secession was going about as poorly as possible, and while Lu Shan was ostensibly the head of this shitstorm, it was the regent Zhuge Liang that was actually pulling the strings. In Chinese culture, Zhuge Liang is remembered as the love child of Leonardo da Vinci and Napoleon Bonaparte. He's always the smartest guy in the room, and so faultless, his story is like reading Golden Age Superman comics. Now in full control of the Shu Han Empire, Zhuge Liang set about repairing the mess Liu Bei had left him. Step 1, repair relationships with the Kingdom of Wu. Send out diplomatic envoys and agree that sure, they had beat the brakes off each other, but that didn't mean they couldn't still be friends. Besides, they may hate each other, but they both hate the Northern Kingdom of Wei even more. Step number 2, send an official to figure out what the hell is going on in Nanjiang. Gao Ding killed that one too. Step 3, re-establish control of Nanjiang and the Nanman tribes.
Marching south and burning down the jungles wouldn't make the Nanman hate them any less.
Victory here would require a bold new strategy.
Zhuge Liang would need to take the hearts and minds approach.
But 30 years of constant warfare had left Shu Han short on generals with more than 2 brain cells, so Zhuge Liang would need to see to this personally or risk another rebellion as soon as they left. Emperor Lu Shan gave Zhuge Liang a ceremonial axe and a big shindig to see him off. The Imperial Guard even escorted him out of the city to the sound of rolling drums and blaring trumpets. Then they slammed shut the gates and thanked their lucky stars it wasn't them about to go south to fight a never-ending guerrilla war and get malaria in a swampy hellhole. A whole host of colorful characters rise up to fight the invading Shu Han Empire. Nanman kings Duosi, Wutugu, and Mulu, and their hordes of elephants and tigers, all of which never existed. Even Meng Huo's wife, Lady Zhurong, is a creation of the novel. I mean, I'm sure the guy was probably married, but his wife wasn't a badass descendant of a fire deity. Oddly enough, the exception here is King Shimoka, a local tribe leader drafted by Liu Bei to fight in the disastrous Battle of Shaoting. He and all his people were killed there, lending some credence to the complaints levied by the Nanman people. The same bevy of fictional characters also appear in the Han forces roster. The novel puts the great heroes Zhao Yun and Wei Yan front and center for the action, when they never so much as sneezed in a southerly direction in history. Regardless, the basics of the story remain the same. As Zhuge Liang's army moved into the Heart of Darkness via riverboat, the rebels led by Gao Ding and Yong Kai built fortifications across the south. But as the barricades went up and he saw that his tribesmen were being enslaved under an entirely new master, Gao Ding began to have the sneaking suspicion that Yong Kai wasn't in this for the liberation of the south. So Gao Ding added the notch of another government official to his belt and killed Yong Kai as well, offering the traitor's head and his personal services to Zhuge Liang the moment the Shu Han arrived. Because if you're gonna be a turncoat, you gotta do it quick. Which left the duped Nanman people leaderless, isolated, alone, and with no choice but to fight to maintain what little sovereignty they still had. The Nanman tribes then elected Meng Huo as their new leader and told him to get to work getting them out of the mess that he created. Zhuge Liang amassed his forces, drew up for battle, and waited for the attack, intending to end the campaign in a single swift battle, hoping that sparing the prisoners and being merciful with their leaders would resolve the conflict. But that didn't happen, and instead it became a prolonged guerrilla war. Zhuge Liang was forced to fight in an inconclusive slog, and soon found that his real enemies were swamp water and mosquitoes, so that the Shu Han soldiers punctuated any victory they managed with uncontrollable defecation and vomiting. With political turmoil and the very real threat of a military invasion back home, Zhuge Liang had no time to dick around in the jungle. But instead of pulling a Gao Ding and cutting off the head of every Nanman noble he found, Zhuge Liang decided to try and take Meng Huo alive.
Which is like trying to relocate a crocodile. It's a great plan so long as you're not the one having to jump on its back.
But after one bold attack too many, Meng Huo overextended himself and was captured. Zhuge Liang then showered him with courtesy and even gave him a tour of the Shu army camp, trying to impress him with their organization and power. And then he let Meng Huo leave.
The Han army would have shit itself in anger if they weren't already doing so because of yellow fever.
This same cycle of Meng Huo's capture and release then repeated, I kid you not, 7 times.
Since the absurd justification for this wasn't recorded, we have to turn back to the Romance of the Three Kingdoms novel again,
which has each defeat becoming more fantastical than the last, with the Nan Man using savage tigers and herds of elephants to attack the Shu Han, eventually cladding themselves in nature itself by making rattan armor and sending whole herds of water buffalo to attack alongside them, which Zhuge Liang outsmarts yet again by crafting huge fire-breathing juggernauts. Because if there's one thing the novels stress, it's that Zhuge Liang cannot be beaten. By the way, this is from the 1994 adaptation of The Romance of the Three Kingdoms, and those oxen are really on fire. It was after this seventh and most humiliating defeat that Meng Huo finally surrendered outright to Zhuge Liang. With no further resistance, Zhuge Liang marched his army to Lake Dian in absolute triumph,
not counting the untold numbers of Shu Han soldiers that were sacrificed for this strategy to work.
And then he jogged off back north again, pausing only to appease an angry river god in a humorous anecdote with Zhuge Liang inventing a new type of steamed bun called a man tao. But this campaign was anything but a peaceful conquest. The fighting didn't stop after the Shu Han army left. Zhuge Liang had subdivided the counties of Nanzhong and put loyalist governors in charge, but their only qualifications were that they were rich and of Han Chinese descent. No local tribesmen were represented, and by restructuring the commanderies, he was able to pit the governors against one another and keep power in his own hands. Indigenous local elites like Meng Huo were appointed as imperial advisors, but with two Han officials as their babysitters. Tribes like the Nan Man were forcibly recruited into imperial state troops, and troublemakers like Gao Ding were sent along with them. He would go on to die in one of Zhuge Liang's endless northern campaigns. The same northern campaigns that were fueled by laborers, soldiers, water buffalo, war horses, gold, silver, leather, salt, cloth, iron, and lacquer from Nanzhong Commandery and the south of China. This heavy taxation would lead to further rebellions in the south, with the Nan Man being forced to learn to play the competing kingdoms against one another for their own safety and independence.
In the end, though, Zhuge Liang's southern campaign is still likely the most successful jungle campaign in history,
saving countless lives through the calculated sacrifice of his own troops, and countless more through the savvy manipulation of the local elite. And though rebellions did continue, it was never again on a scale that disrupted local life or the transport of much-needed war supplies. And in a period marked by never-ending endemic warfare, that's a win in my book.
I'm Cody Bonds, and this has been a mostly accurate history of Zhuge Liang's Southern Campaign.
You can find more mostly accurate histories on this channel, and can look for an upcoming episode on the Trojan Wars to release soon. So subscribe if you'd like to be notified about that, or join the channel and help in its creation. And as always, thanks for watching.